Science. Right? How great is science? Can I get a show of hands if you love science? Nice. Good for science. Okay, art. Show of hands if you love art. Air high five for art. Nice. I don't know if you guys noticed, but I actually raised my hand for both items. Many of you did as well. That's right, there's plenty of people out there who love art and love science, many who engage in both practices. And there's a growing number of people like myself who do so simultaneously, and who maybe don't even consider the two, art and science, to be inherently separate things. I didn't always think this way. In fact, I used to hate science and mathematics, and I did horribly in these in school. It wasn't until college that things started to change. Art class was always my favorite because there were no wrong answers and there were no silly questions. It was an opportunity to get my hands dirty and experiment with new materials and processes. So later in college, I was given opportunities to actually combine the two, art and science, together into one practice, primarily in the way of computer science, engineering, technology, and maybe a little psychology. So today I want to share with all of you a transformation from someone with a mindset like this, art versus science, into an artist who loves science. I'm Bryan Cera, and I make projects that explore mainly three things. One, technology's potential to change how we think and how we move. Two, the strangely intimate relationships we have with our technologies. And three, a general celebration of new technologies' ability to reframe information and data and their reciprocal relationships to matter and ideas. In other words, I make what many people have referred to, like I said, as useless machines. I prefer to call them art. Sometimes I call them my precious children, depending on how passionate I'm feeling that day. Though I will say that typically I reserve that title for my cats. I mean, look at these guys, come on. But let's go back to that idea of useless machines, useless technology. That's interesting to me. What exactly about a given technology makes it so useful? I always find myself asking questions like these. In my undergrad, I was becoming really interested in virtual spaces. That is, in spaces that do not physically exist, yet we spend much of our time inhabiting. So at the time, YouTube had just come out. Facebook was still kind of in its infancy. And video games featuring robust virtual worlds were becoming my generation's drug of choice. So whether it's video games or message boards, instant messaging, email, social media platforms, we essentially give up our bodies temporarily to exist in this weird cloud. And it is a very disembodied experience, aside from maybe some subtle movement at the fingertips on the keyboard, maybe a little wrist action on the mouse. So is there no room for a body in our typical virtual space? It seems bizarre to me, but it's ubiquitous. It's commonplace, right? So I decided to build Controller. Controller is the name of my first interactive artwork, and it actually took the form of a multimedia installation that combined some cutting-edge computer vision and motion tracking technology with a virtual space, one that I spent way too much time in growing up. Wait for it. Super Mario World. So the result here is different than, say, your typical virtual reality, where the goal is usually to create an immersive and realistic environment. Here, everything is abstracted or simplified, and this, including your body, and this changes the way you experience your own body. My favorite part about this work is seeing these totally non-artsy-fartsy people come into an art gallery and dance about like they're part of this avant-garde performance. But there's some interesting play here between the idea that we have complete control over technology and that maybe technology has a little control over us. I'm actually working on a revision of this work where you use the silhouette of your entire body to explore the space. I'm about to experiment here a little bit. So my next project followed this idea, except this time I wanted to see what kind of sounds I could get out of participants. So I created Pong, an interactive video console, very similar to the classic video game Pong, but with a twist. Instead of using joysticks to move the paddles up and down, you do so by screaming into a microphone. Pong, by the way, is the combination of the words pong and sung, and while this might not sound exactly like singing to you, the project did elicit some amazing and absurd sounds by participants. The key here is that competitive instinct totally wins out over any kind of reservation or skepticism. Even in a pristine space like an art gallery or a library, which is actually the last place I installed this. So I love playing with relationships and kind of creating these weird relationships between people and technology, but I'm also very interested in exploring existing ones. In grad school, I supplemented my formal education with knowledge from artists and makers on the internet. So on sites like Instructables.com or Thingiverse, knowledge is transformed from its typical state of a commodity, something you own and buy and sell, into a kind of currency that you exchange, you teach, you learn, you share in this global system of collaborative problem solving. My favorite community to follow is actually the cosplay community. So cosplay, for the layman, is this huge group of people all over the world that take costume making and wearing very seriously. So normally an army of costumed folk would just make me nervous. But here their passion to take objects and wearables that they've grown up with in video games, comic books, and movies, and then make them real was inspiring. So I decided that my next project would be some kind of wearable technological object. And like the makers and artists I was following, I would share my process from conception through fabrication for free on the internet as a way to give something back to this community I'd been learning from. Okay, so around this time, I happened to hear on the radio an interview with this woman, Sherry Turkle. She's an MIT professor who sort of studies how technology shapes and alters us socially and psychologically. It was one of those situations where everything the woman said in this interview, I found myself cheering, yes, that, oh my God, that is totally what I'm saying. Or a more academic response, I realized I was in dialogue with Turkle. Anyway, she brings up this case study where high school students are reporting feeling their cell phones vibrating in their pockets, despite the fact that their phones aren't even on them, maybe left in their locker or at home for the day. And Sherry Turkle calls this the phantom ring. And this is a reference to the phantom limb phenomenon experienced by amputees, where they still feel a lost limb. I was super inspired by this. In fact, I regularly experience the phantom ring. Oh, no? Okay. But I thought maybe I could fold this idea into my wearable tech project. So I came up with this concept for this armor-like shell that you wear on your hand, and it replaces the functionality of your hand with the functionality of a cell phone. I thought this could be a fun way to literalize Turkle's notion of technology as this phantom limb. So the result was Glove One, a 3D printed wearable cell phone, which in order to use requires that you sacrifice your hand.
Hello everyone, I'm from your telephone company.
I posted this video of the functional prototype on YouTube and it went completely viral. I think that a lot of people mistook it for like an actual product that was being launched. And I got all kinds of hilarious feedback. I remember one comment specifically was something like, "This is ridiculous. No one would ever be willing to make this kind of sacrifice for a phone." Which is totally true. I mean, that's kind of the point of the project, right? But hang on a second. Don't we make sacrifices for our phones? I remember a time when I could disappear if I wanted simply by leaving the house. I had no responsibility to be constantly available 24 hours a day. That's a huge sacrifice, not to mention the attention that we sacrifice for our digital devices. I remember around this time everyone was getting smartphones, and I was still using one of those free regular phones, like a Motorola or something. And people would say to me, "Bryan, why don't you get an iPhone?" And I'd be like, "Because I spent all my money on this stupid glove phone." Another project that explores human and technology relationships is Array. And Array stands for Arm Robot for Artistic Inquiry. And it actually comes out of my lifelong fascination with robots. Robots, I think, are these incredible performance machines. And by that, I mean they're designed to outperform, to perform for, and in some cases, to perform humans. So I thought it could be a fun challenge to try to design and build a robot who attempts not to perform. What would that look like? Well, first, what constitutes performance? We're always performing, right? You've got scholastic performance, job performance, athletic performance, sexual performance, social performance, TEDx performance. I know that, personally, one of the only times I'm pretty sure I'm definitely not performing is when I'm procrastinating. So, Array was designed and programmed to be a vertical articulated six-axis robotic arm whose sole purpose is to procrastinate. For his exhibition, I built a 20-foot track for him to traverse, and I programmed him to do things like pace back and forth, neurotically check the refrigerator. This is something I always do when I'm procrastinating for whatever reason. And then, of course, he looks at pictures of cats on the internet. One of the most common comments I got about this project was that your robot is completely useless, which is totally true. But I will say, I think it's interesting that by making a robot, this machine, act a little bit more like a human, it instantly becomes useless and absurd. So, thank you. So I teach classes in digital media in computer programming and creating circuits with microcontrollers, and I regularly encourage my students to make useless machines and to design absurd or futile software, because why not? It becomes more than an exercise in computer science and technology. It's a way of critically thinking about ourselves, about our minds, our bodies, and our human relationships. Some of the work coming out of my classes include projects like this. This is Kylie's anthropomorphized iPhone furniture. We were creating 3D printable objects, and she wanted to give her phone a comfy spot to recharge in. This is Shay's 3D printed origami wardrobe. He wanted to create a system to neatly hang and display his digitally imaged origami hipster shirts. And he said, and I love this, that he was going to literally fold together a new way of making with an old one. This is a project by a group of young men called Auto Ball, which is a remote controlled ball. So the idea here, I guess, is that you could play sports without getting up. And this is Fractured Perspective. This group of young women created a wall piece that presents to the viewer an image of a landscape. And that image mechanically fractures and rebuilds itself depending on movement in the viewing space. So a regular part of all my classes is something I call process blogs. I have all my students detail their progress through a project from start to finish, all of their projects, online on a blog. So this not only creates a robust platform for students to share and collaborate with each other, but it encourages them to join this broader dialogue of makers and artists on the internet. Again, I see great potential in the internet's ability to reframe information and knowledge not as commodities, but as currencies, rich currencies, in this global system of making, teaching, sharing, and collaborating. Which brings me to the last project I'll share with you tonight. If any of you have taken an art history class, you'll know that the thing pictured here is not just fictional, this is art. This is a ready-make by Marcel Duchamp, an artist way ahead of his time, who in 1917 came up with the idea of the ready-made art object. And he began to take everyday ordinary objects and elevate them to the status of art simply by changing their context. In this case, putting a urinal on a pedestal in an art gallery. Well, Duchamp also happened to be a passionate and celebrated chess player. A good friend and collaborator of mine, Scott Kildall, became intrigued, maybe even a little obsessed with this archival photograph. This is a photograph of Duchamp's one-of-a-kind hand-carved chess set. Apparently, aside from this photograph, the set itself had kind of been lost to time. It hasn't been seen for many decades. No one knows where it is. So Scott approached me with the idea of recreating this set using some computer modeling software as a way to kind of resurrect this lost object. I loved the idea. Okay, and so we decided we were going to call this project our Ready Make, in homage to Duchamp's Ready Made. And I began to pull relative dimensions directly from the archival photograph and kind of took the 2D geometry and extruded it back into 3D space. And one by one, we digitally resurrected this set. We also decided, as to further recontextualize these objects, that we would share them for free on the internet. So anyone with access to a 3D printer could print and own their very own Marcel Duchamp chess set. But the next part is my favorite bit. We started to ask artists and makers to print the set for themselves and then to document it in the style of the original archival photograph. So this becomes a really interesting study of materiality and objecthood, as we've taken this once actual object from virtual back to actual and then back to virtual again. I have to wonder what Marcel Duchamp himself would think about 3D printing technology, about its potential to reframe art, object, and ownership. By creating projects that explore relationships between humans and technology, and by both critiquing and celebrating those relationships, I've found one perfect marriage of art and science. Sherry Turkle says it's critical that we live examined lives with our technologies, and I think that's perfect advice. And I'll add that one of the best ways I've found of doing this is to really engage with technology on a deeper level. Perhaps we can truly become empowered by and inspired by our technologies by simply making stuff, by experimenting and exploring, being comfortable with wrong answers and silly questions, and by not being afraid of making useless machines. Thank you.